This is the first video we're going to be doing in the Python series. And the Python programming language, it's an interpreted high-level general-purpose programming language released in 1991, meaning the language is over 29 years old. It's a language that has been on a steady rise since its release, even though adoption has been slow. But the past 3 years has not seen a better time for the Python programming language, with the language close to it and popularity of developers' choices, JavaScript programming language. This tutorial is going to serve as the introductory video to our Python series, and we're going to be looking at the Python basics, the basis of the Python programming language. You're also going to be looking at the control flow structure or the control flow within the Python programming language. To get started with the Python programming language, you can visit the python.org and visit the download tab, and it's among the menu. And the Python interpreter comes in various operating systems. You can find it on Windows, Linux, or Mac operating system, depending on the operating system of choice. So my IDE is the Visual Studio Code. I'm also going to leave a link to all the marketplace plugins within Visual Studio Code I'll be working with. So if you want to have the exact development environment as me, you can actually just download that and install them within the Visual Studio Code. The other IDEs you might want to work with, like the PyCharm, and it's another Python favorite for developers, but personally I prefer to work with Visual Studio Code. So you can actually work with PyCharm or try both of them out and decide on the IDE that is best suited for you. So without wasting much time, let's get started. Welcome to Seed Media. So to get started with Python programming, you need to first of all install Python on your development machine. If you're making use of a Mac computer, the installation is quite simple. You can easily make use of Homebrew to get the installation up and running. And it's, if you're making use of a Mac computer, after installation via Homebrew, it's going to automatically add the Python to your path. So you can easily go within your terminal and type Python, and it will execute the current Python version you have. Well, if you're by default Python comes with Linux and Mac computers. If your device comes with two different Python versions, probably comes with Python 2 and you've recently just installed Python 3, you might need to write Python and add 3 in front of it to tell your computer that you actually want to run the Python 3 interpreter. So if you write Python dash version, it tells you the current version of Python you're running as your default. I currently have 3.8.6 as my default version, even though I have multiple Python installations on my computer. The same applies to a Linux-based distro, probably Ubuntu, or whatever Linux-based distro you're making use of. In your Linux distro, you can simply write sudo apt install and the Python 3 to get the latest version of Python 3 installed. And the same applies to having Python and numerical 3 attached to it when running Python 3 code if you have multiple versions of Python installed. On Windows 10, it's a little bit different, so I'll head over to the Windows computer and just quickly get the installation up and running. So over here in Windows 10, we've downloaded the Python interpreter from the python.org website. And to get that running, all you need to do is just click install now. But don't forget to check add Python 3 to path, so you can easily run Python from your command prompt, and that's all you need to do to get Python up and running. So I'll pause the video, let the installation finish, and I'll get back to you. The installation is done. It says setup was successful. You can close this. We don't need all this. I'll simply open the command prompt in Windows, and we should be able to run the Python command directly here. Yeah, and that's just it because we actually added it to path. So if we say then exit, say Python dash version, and it shows you the current version of Python installed. If you don't want to run that directly from command prompt, you can always click on the start menu and select all apps, and you can find Python interpreter within the list of apps that you have installed. So you can click on the IDLE. You can also run this default Python interactive shell that comes with the Python installation, or you simply just make use of command prompt. So I'll head back over to the Mac computer. Let's get started. So on the Mac computer, I'm going to expand our terminal, clear it out, and simply type Python. We can enter into our interactive shell. Python interactive shell allows for arithmetic operations. You can simply write 2 plus 2 and it gives you the result 4, where 2 plus 2 is known as an expression, and if you write 2 only, it returns back the value of 2. So we're looking at the math operators in Python, and it functions exactly the same way as operators or arithmetic operators in regular mathematics. And I will be discussing the math operators in Python based on their order of precedence. When we talk about order of precedence, it means that if all these operators or a couple of these operators are lined up in the same equation, the operator with the higher order of precedence than the other ones that are lined up with it is going to be executed or considered first before the other operators are considered. So based on the order of precedence, those operators with the higher order of precedence are considered first than the operators with lower order of precedence if they are in the same equation. So the operator with the higher order of precedence is the exponent operator, which takes the left operand and raises it to a power of the right operand. That's to say that 3 exponent 2 gives us 9. That's 3 raised to the power of 2 gives us 9. And it's followed by the modulus operator that takes the value of the left operand, divide it by the value of the right operand, and return the remainder. If you say 4 modulus 2, it's going to give us zero because it has no remainder value. So after the modulus operator, we have what we call the float quotient or the integer division that takes the division of values and returns the exact value without actually turning the floating values attached to it. Let's say we have a value of 5 float division by 2. Returns 2, and is followed by the division value 5 divided by 2 returns 2.5, and the division operator is followed by the multiplication operator, which is 5 times 2, it gives us 10, and the subtraction, which is next, is the subtraction operator, 5 minus 2 gives us 3, and the operator with the lowest precedence is the addition operator, represented with the plus sign, 2 plus 2 gives us 4. So based on the knowledge we have now, if we were to say, let's say 2 multiplied by 5 plus 3, pause the video and guess the answer and run it and see. It gives us 13 because the reason is this, the multiplication operator has a higher precedence than the addition operator, so it adds 5 to 2 first before adding 3 to the summation of 5 times 2. It also force operators to carry out specific actions regardless of their precedence by enclosing them in brackets. So for example, if we say 2 plus 3 times 6, guess what the value is going to be? Remember that the addition operator has a lower precedence than the multiplication operator. So the interpreter is going to do 6 times 3, which gives us 18, before adding the value of 2. So it's going to result in 20. But if we're to write the same value and enclose this in brackets, forcing the interpreter to execute the addition operator, which is of lower precedence than the multiplication operator, we get 30. Some of the basic data types that we're going to be looking at in the Python programming language is the integer, the floating point, and the string data type. For example, we've been looking at the integer all along in this tutorial. An integer is basically 2, positive number or a negative value, and it can be minus 1. A floating point comes with, it's extended to the decimal point values, 2.5, 30.3. You know, these are floating bar values. And a string in Python is enclosed in a single quote or a double quote. Let's say seed media, double quote, enter, it returns back the seed media. And those are strings in the Python programming language. You can carry out string concatenation, meaning that we can have seed, use the plus sign to concatenate it to media, to run that, and we get seed media. We can also have seed media, and we'll multiply that by 5. What is actually going on here is not actually a multiplication as we have it integers. What it's trying to tell us is that you want to replicate this 5 times, and you hit enter and it replicates the seed media 5 times. Yeah, but if we were to say seed plus 2, it's going to throw an error. The reason is the seed is a string and 2 is an integer. It says can only concatenate string and not integer. Python also has what we call variables, and think of a variable as a housing object or as a box or as a simple container where values can be stored it in. And in the declaration of Python, variables are actually very simple. All you need to do is just declare the name out. So we can say cars, and I use the assignment operator, the equal sign, to assign values to it. And we can call this, let's say, Toyota. Save, and if you call back cars, it prints out Toyota. So you can assign values of different types to a variable and use them for different operations and actually have your values returned back to you. Python also allows you to print out values using a special function called print. Pass the value of what you want to, or pass the variable name or value of what you want to print, and it prints out the value. You can also accept inputs from users using a special keyword called input, and you can pass a message with your input. Let's say enter your name, please. Save that. Enters, and a request for us to enter, we enter seed media, enter, and returns back our name. The values that are accepted via inputs can also be stored within variables. So you can say a variable called name and call it input and say enter your name again. We'll close that. Let's give it a space. Save that. Okay, sorry, I used two different types of quotes. Enter your name, I will say seed. Save that. And we can print out the value of name, and it returns back seed. When you use the input keyword or the input function, all values that come through the input function are converted to strings by default, meaning that you cannot take numerical values from the input function and use them to carry out calculations. For example, you can say age, you can say input. Okay, let's say this age equals to input. Say enter your age. And you say 22, and you now say age multiplied by 3. What it did was it didn't carry out a numerical multiplication. What instead, it carried out replication of the value, the 22 values, it replicated it 3 times. If we wanted to make use of age as a numeric value, we'll have to convert it to age. And we'll say int, we can now say multiply by 3, and it gives us 66. The other special function within Python that you can use to convert an integer to a string. For example, you can say str22 and returns it as a string. We also have the len length function that tells us the length of a specific variable or string. So we can say len age and returns 2. It tells us it checks for the value of the length of the value of the, it checks for the length of the value stored within age and returns 2. You can also say len seed media and returns 10. We also have the float function, and you can take timeout and read on that. It's basically the same thing. It operates just like the int and the length function. And Python comes with a lot of built-in functions that you don't need to cram all this, but over time, as you work with the programming language, you're going to get more used to it. Another question that might come to your mind is, what if you want to accept an input value and print it out, get that value that you've printed out and display it to the screen? We have what we call the string formatting, and in Python we can say name equals to kindly enter your kindly enter your first name, and we say, let's say seed, and we can print out, put an F and say your name is, in the bracket you say name, in curly brackets you say name, save that and enter back. So your name is seed. So the F here is telling us that we want to pass a variable or a character that is not directly a string within a statement or within the string, and have that value displayed when the string is printed out, like it's part of the string. So basically, we've covered the basics of Python, and in the next video, we'll be looking at the flow structure, control flow. I think this video is getting a little bit too long. We'll be looking at the control flow within Python. So don't forget to hit the subscribe button. Don't forget to like it, and I'll see you at the next video. Thank you.